Welcome to episode 5 of the Sound of Spurs podcast presented by Frost Bank. And we are very pleased to be joined by Gene Banks. He might not be a household name for you guys that haven't been paying attention to the Spurs for all these 50 years, but he's a household name to me because we grew up in the same neighborhood in Philadelphia. And I've been knowing Gene Banks since he was a West Philly speed boy back in the mid-70s. And we'll talk about that for just a moment. But first of all, Gene Banks coming our way from North Carolina, Greensboro, North Carolina today. Thank you so much for joining us and welcome to the Sound of Spurs podcast.
Well, it's a pleasure, especially for a place where I started my NBA career under the allegiance of Stan Allback, the late Stan Allback. And it was one of my times in my life, the 4 years being there, was one of the greatest portions of my life that I will always remember.
You've had an amazing life, Gene, in the sport of basketball. And we want to start in Philly. And of course, it's an easy place for me to start because that's where I came from, too.
You're a Philly guy.
Yeah, no question about that. I was at West Catholic High. You were at West Philly High, about two blocks away.
That's right.
We had a guy named Michael Brooks, who you remember very well, the late Michael Brooks, who died just a couple of years ago over in Switzerland because he stayed over there overseas when he coached. But Lewis Lloyd was at Overbrook. You were at West Philly. You had a teammate named Clarence Tillman at West Philly. It was a great player. There were good players all over the city. And growing up in that kind of environment, just take us back through those times and how competitive it was on the streets of Philadelphia when you were earning your stripes.
It's really interesting because basketball was really at a high level. And Philadelphia's always had some great, great players going back to Wayne Hightower to, you look at Walt Hazard, who changed his name to a Muslim name afterwards, Andre McCarter. And I mean, there's a list of guys, Fred Stokes. There's so many names of players, and I came up through that era. My dad played basketball a lot, and I didn't really like basketball starting out 7, 8 years old. And I used to go in a car with him when he went to different places and different spots in Diamond Street and Woodland Avenue, and he played ball. He was very good. He was very good. Wasn't great, like kind of that thing. And I was in the car, and I didn't want to have anything to do with it. I was playing like I was Evel Knievel or something, that kind of thing. And then after he got finished playing, with the guys out there, he would call me over and he was shooting. He would throw the ball at me. He'd give me a wedge. He'd trip me. So he made me learn how to love the game because I really didn't like it. And it was our time every time we went out, just hang with dad. And it wasn't like he was trying to teach me how to follow through anything. It was just me and him playing. And then he started putting me on teams with his team, just to put me on there with him, and he covered my back. And I was playing with the older guys. And that's what helped me with my game. I learned, as you know, when you in Philadelphia, you playing these pickup games. If your team loses, you're going to wait a while before your team gets back on that court. So I had to learn how to play hard, aggressive. And that was one of the biggest things of my career that made me, because I knew I had to play hard all the time. And when I played against my peers, then, I had a little advantage against it because I learned all the old tricks. But went from there, and I'm originally from South Philadelphia. Originally, I spent a lot of time. We were born and raised in that area, and I even spent 3 years with my grandparents down there. Went to Landreth Elementary School, which is where Andre McCarter went, which is also, I'll put a shout out to Mr. Dan Baker, who was my fifth grade teacher, who's been the voice of the Phillies and the Eagles for the last 20 something years.
Public address announcer, yeah.
Yep, he was one of these great guy, and just playing there. Then I got bussed. I got bussed. My mom and dad separated more or less. And my mom basically was remarried and to Walt Williams. And Walt Williams is the first cousin of Sherman Hemsley from the Jeffersons. So we saw him a lot coming into the house. But my dad got my stepfather got a big raise. And that's when we moved from South Philly to West Philly. That's how I wound up in West Philadelphia. Make a long story short, I went there, started playing basketball, playing for a little team called Clark Park. We played against a team called Sherwood Recreation. Sherwood Recreation Center was one of the known recreation centers, and they had a coach named James Flint. James Flint was the black Bobby Knight. Everything that goes with Bobby Knight throwing chairs and all that, that's him. And you know who his son is. His son is Bruiser Flint.
Right. Right.
And it's so interesting because even when I was at moving forward to West Philadelphia, Hi Bruiser would be in my room. He stayed in my room on the road trips, helped me fix my shoes and all that stuff. So there's a big history. So I go to West Philadelphia, And the thing about West Philadelphia, when I was with my dad at the time, I was living in the John Bartram area, the district in West Philadelphia. And that's where Kobe Bryant's father went, Joe Bryant.
Jelly Bean and Earl of Pearl.
And Earl of Pearl went to John Bartram. So we had John Bartram, Overbrook, and West Philadelphia, mega power basketball. And we were in the same conference on top of that. So I wound up going to West Philadelphia. I wasn't able to even go to West Philadelphia the first 2 weeks. They thought the coach was recruiting, which wasn't. I just moved from my dad's back to my mom's. I wanted to move back with my mom's, my brother and sister. And that's how I wound up in West Philadelphia and played on a star-studded team my sophomore year. We were 25-0. And on that team was Tim Smith, who played at the University of Pennsylvania when they went to the Final Four and all that. So he was my mentor, along with Wilbert Lorick and Mike Collins and Calvin Goodwin. We had an unbelievable team, coached by a great coach, Joe Goldenberg. He steered me through it. And then they left. And then the following year comes in a great player who I'd known since eighth grade, Clarence Aggie Tillman. Clarence was known throughout South Philadelphia. He went to McDaniels Elementary School, and make a long story short, they got awards. Sad to say, and I'm still dealing with this, Clarence passed away last year. Aggie passed away, as we talked about Michael Brooks, who passed away, who and I became good friends, and we go back, and Lewis Lloyd. These three iconic high school players have all gone in the last, say, 5 or 6 years.
Yeah, it's been tough. You had such a great career at West Philly. You could have gone anywhere. You got letters from every major college in the country. Bill Foster recruited you to go to Duke. And Bill Foster, of course, is from suburban Philadelphia, Delaware County guy. I got to know Bill Foster very well later when he was the basketball commissioner for the Big 12 Conference and the Southwest Conference. Great basketball mind. What made you decide to go down to Tobacco Row there from Philly all the way down to Durham, North Carolina?
And this is really the truth. It was really divine intervention. It really was. I mean, I was visiting all these schools and so forth. University of Penn was really top on the list. The pressure of staying home was major, but I didn't take that as a pressure situation. But I would have went to University of Penn hands down. The problem with the University of Penn was that the Ivy League did not allow freshmen to play varsity basketball. And it was like that. I remember I heard it was like that during the older times. I mean, Charlie Scott and Art Heyman, the Duke days in the 60s, all these guys, Lou Alcindor and UCLA, you weren't allowed to play varsity basketball. You had to play on a freshman team. I felt that if I was able to play varsity, why would I play on a freshman team? I know the season's a little bit less, but I didn't. So that eliminated Penn. Villanova was in there with Raleigh. Raleigh thought he was going to get me to get there. But then I went to visit UCLA, and a kid from the inner city going out to see the palm trees, going to Johnny Carson's show, going to the mansion of Hugh Hefner.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, man. I mean, if they had the letter of intent that day, I would have signed it. I'm going to tell you right now, it would have been real easy. But what made the point was I came back. I wasn't able to stay at home for a while because recruiting was getting crazy. But I came back finally. My mom, I was still hiding out at my aunt's and my grandparents' house. And I told my, I said, Mom, I really don't know where I want to go. Every school is just as nice, is just as wonderful as the next school. So as I get ready to go into my room, my mom said, I want you to stay in this room and I want you to pray about it. That's what she said. I said, okay. So she closed the door and she locked my door. And I was like, my mom's never locked my door before. And it was one of those doors with the old skeleton key, that kind of thing. And I laid down and I put my music on. I was a Barry White fan. Everybody cracks on me. I was a Barry White fan. Put the music on. I laid back. And I had saw a brochure of Duquesne University, Duquesne. That's where Norm Nixon went to school. In Pittsburgh. He had a jersey on that had Dukes on it. But you didn't see that as it said Duke. So when I went to sleep, my mind was thinking of that picture of Norm Nixon and the Duke on it. And I fell asleep dreaming about wearing a Duke uniform. When I woke up the next morning, honestly, truly, I said, Mom, I know where I want to go. And my mom always taught us about visions and all that kind of stuff because I was raised in a Pentecostal church. And she said, that's going to help you. And I told her, she didn't ask me where I wanted to go. She said, let me call the school. She called the school. They said, don't let them come up here for another 2 or 3 hours. We want to get the media out. And, I just basically made that decision. It was some other things thrown in because I did like Bill Foster as well that goes on for it. But the major decision was I woke up and I said, this is where I want to go. When I go into the press conference, I sit there. I didn't tell anybody. I told Julius Thompson, who was the writer for the Bulletin. I gave him the scoop earlier. He came over and did it. When I sat down, everybody was sitting there trying to figure out where I'm going. No one really knew. No one knew. I didn't tell anybody. And I said, I want to take my talents to Duke University. Everybody, they said, what the hell? They said, does Duke even have a basketball team? They said, what the hell is a Duke University?
Carolina was dominating them back then, right?
Duke was in last place for like 3 years in a row or something like that. And I watched him a few times. They had the guy named Tate Armstrong, who was a golden boy there. And Jaminski was a freshman and whatever. But I saw them, but I didn't really pay attention. But that was sometimes you listen to your conscience and listen to your spirituality. And I did. Everything I dreamt about, honest to truth, everything I dreamt about happened my freshman year. So I actually believed in, I trust in God, and he led me to that dynasty. I said, I want to go to Duke and help make them a national power. And it happened.
You certainly did that. They made the championship game your freshman year.
First year.
And I remember, Gene, cheering on you from afar because you were a Philly guy. And I, like a lot of people in Philly, wanted you to go to Villanova or Penn. Mm-hmm. And, of course, you mentioned Penn and the Ivy League. They made the Final Four, as you mentioned, in 79 with Tim Smith and those guys. Tony Price, of course, from New York, was on that ball club. So the Ivy League back then, and I grew up in the Palestra. And I know you played many games there or got a chance to watch many games there when you were a kid. That was just part of that great basketball tradition. So now you go to Duke, you have a great college career, and let's move on to the Spurs. You were the 28th pick.
Well, hold on. You got to remember something. You got to remember one thing. We played Penn my freshman year to get to the Final Four. We had to beat them, and then we played Villanova the next night. This was divine intervention. It really was. And Penn was up on us by 4 points with the ball, with no shot clock. And they challenged Jaminski, and Jaminski made some big, and said we beat them. Then we played Villanova, and we blew them out kind of early. So I just wanted to put that in, which was amazing, that turnaround of events.
Right. And you had some excellent college teammates. And I know I follow you on Facebook, Gene. I know you stay in touch with guys like Jaminski. And Sparnarkle and Kenny Denard and the guys that you played with at Duke. So that must have been a real special time for you in terms of your maturity as a person and as a player.
We were young kids. I mean, we were young kids. The thing is, I think that with Goldenberg's training, the practices weren't hard at all for me because Goldenberg really trained us to be that way. The guys, Mike Jaminski, amazing guy, 6'11", the aircraft carrier, Jim Sparnarkle, Jersey guy. He's doing NCAA games all the time now. Kenny Denard and I became, it's like a storybook story of the two of us being connected. We're connected even to this very, very day. And we were a bunch of young freshman kids, freshmen and sophomores with one senior. And we just had so much fun playing by. It was the same as being leaving from West Philly, going to Duke. And Bill Foster was the architect, but Lou Getz was also the main guy that knew how to handle Bill. Bill be all over the place, but it was a great time for basketball, and we captivated the whole, not just the state, but the whole nation of us young kids blowing bubblegum, playing, having a good time. We didn't care. It was basketball at its highest level of fun.
And you guys put Duke on the basketball map, Gene. I don't think there's any question about that. Duke has been a powerhouse for a long time now.
Yeah, I mean, they talk about Coach K now, and I love Coach K. I had him for my senior year, which is the only thing I don't want to say I regret, but the sad part is that I wish I had another year with him because I saw his growth. I saw the things, great motivator, a great teacher of basketball, fantastic person, awesome, awesome family man. That's the one thing I love about him more than anything else. You know, he has his faults. We all know nobody's perfect, but one thing you can't fault him on, his family. He loves his family. He loves basketball. And he went through some trial tribulations. So he's the epitome of a man coming from out of the ground up. And he also said that to me and to Kenny Denard. He says, the one thing that I have to say, when I came in, I didn't know really how to coach elite players. So he was learning. He was adjusting. We were learning. We were adjusting. But, Bill Foster was unique. he was whimsical. Silly, he had one-liners, and that's what caught my eye with Bill Foster, and it just all connected.
Now we come to the Alamo City, Gene. What was it like to get drafted by the Spurs in 1981? The Spurs had already been in the NBA for a few years, but you joined a pretty good roster with the Iceman and Mike Mitchell, and Stan Albeck was your coach.
Well, here's the thing. I was projected going to top 10 of the draft. You got to remember, my last game at Duke in the NIT, I broke my wrist in half. We were playing against North Carolina A&T, the first round of the NIT, which is what we were in under Coach K in my senior year. And I went up to block a shot, my legs got cut, and I snapped my left wrist in half, my navicular bone. So now you got to remember, this is late in the time. The draft is going to be in 4 months. And I dropped down. You know, I went to visit the Lakers. I've been in Indiana. They saw me. I got my cast off just in time. But I dropped down to the 28th pick. And I was, believe me, I was sitting there and I was not angry. I was hurt. I was really hurt that I dropped. But it was probably the greatest thing for me in my career ever to get drafted by the 28th pick with the Spurs. You know, they said, you know, we got a first round pick in the second round. Pretty much. I was the first pick in the second round with them. And I came to a team that was established. You had the Bruce brothers, which was Kevin Mastani, Dave Corzine, Paul Griffin.
Oberding, right? Mark Oberding was one of those guys?
Oberding was there that 1 year, then they traded him the following year. Mm-hmm. But I got a situation where I had veteran players teaching me the game. I was coming off the bench. Stan was yelling at me all the time, but I knew I had to earn my stripes. But to be on a team, and then here's the topper. I'm with one of the greatest players in basketball, George the Iceman Gervin. Couldn't have had a better experience in my life starting out. And then the following year, as you well know, the spot opened up, and we got Artis Gilmore. We traded for Mike Mitchell. And here we go, me and Mike Mitchell bookends. But having Artis Gilmore balance things out, and that helped us to the point where my game, I can play defense, I can bang with strength, but I get out on a break, and my IQ is pretty good, and my field goal percentage. So Griffin and Rastani were ahead of me in that power position to get that spot. But I beat him out. I'm not saying I beat him out, but Stan looked at me and says, I'm going to take my chances on you.
Talking about joining with Mike Mitchell and playing for Coach Albeck. I think Johnny Moore was there. So just those early days with the Spurs, Gene, and you know, what you learned and how you kind of fit in with those guys.
Well, it's interesting that once we got Mike Mitchell, who was an all-star with the Cleveland Cavaliers, we were lucky to get him, and then getting Artis coming in, and then Johnny Moore being young and what he did, we formulated something that was really special. The game was already, Spurs were already a fast-paced team, but I think I added something to that. Artis added something to that, and it became a situation where we became exciting. You know, if you really look back on the Spurs history during that time, you have to remember that there were some top teams. Philadelphia was good. Boston was good. The Houston Rockets. But we were in that classification of the top five best teams in the NBA. People don't talk about we getting knocked out by the Lakers in the Western Conference Finals back-to-back 2 years. You got to look at that and say, hey, you know, the Spurs were serious, and we were exciting. We sold out games because of Iceman, and we were an exciting basketball team. And playing on that team was wonderful, and I knew my role. The thing I knew my role, I knew to play defense, get out on the break, and that's when Johnny would hit me. And the Hemisphere Arena was, I mean, I played at Cameron Indoor Stadium, which was electric with Duke, but the Hemisphere Arena was totally different than any other league, any other arena in the NBA. You know, everybody had this, but the fans, the baseline bombs, you know, they still entrenched in my spirit, and they got me fired up. Just a great time to go somewhere when you feel that it was not a good thing, but it was a great thing for me.
We had Captain Late on the podcast, James Silas, a few weeks ago, and he's still good friends with Dr. J, Julius Erving. And he says that of all his friends who played on other teams, Julius really disliked the baseline bums, Gene. They created kind of an atmosphere that opposing players did not like.
Yeah, I mean, they were intense. You know, they were intense, and they give Kareem a hard time all the time. And it's really interesting that it was tough to beat us in our place.
Was it an adjustment for you moving to San Antonio? Now, you, of course, had spent some time in the South at Duke, but that's always an adjustment when you move to a new city.
Well, you know, I moved from Philadelphia to the South to go to Duke. So it was I was looking forward to a new adventure, a new place. I've always liked to learn things. And it was for me to go where I went to San Antonio, it was a different Hispanic type of feel, culture. The way the weather was different. So the adjustment didn't hurt me at all. Matter of fact, I just thrived on it.
This is the 50th anniversary, Gene, of the Spurs. And of course, that's one of the reasons we're doing this podcast. When you take yourself out of the equation and the few years that you spent in San Antonio, what do you think the legacy of the Spurs franchise is in the NBA?
Coming from the NBA, one of the top, the history from the ABA, which is great. That's something that no one can take away from anything. And with the, you know, the colored ball and that kind of thing, and the excitement of basketball. And then it carried on later on. Popovich comes in with his geniusness and keeping it going. It's hard to say. It's Boston, New York, Philadelphia. You're established elite teams, as you know. But San Antonio's in that, you know, it's in that thing. Detroit is in the top, but San Antonio has to be in that top five of the most established organizations in NBA basketball for a lot of reasons. And I'm glad to be a part of that tradition.
You sure are. Did you follow that team when Duncan, Ginobili, and Parker were doing their thing?
Oh, most definitely. I mean, I follow the Spurs all the time and got a chance. I knew Tim, didn't know him, but I saw him when he was at Wake Forest. Ginobili, I saw when he was a junior in Argentina. I watched him when he, I saw him because I played in Argentina for 2 years. So I saw him as he came up and watched him play. And Tony Parker was always gracious to me. So it's really interesting that it was hard not to follow the Spurs. It was hard not to. So they were a part of me, even though I got traded later on. But they were, you know, Angelo DeRosos and Bob Bass and just going on Lawrence Payne, just people in the administration that I had a great relationship with. And I did a lot of stuff in the community, so it's part of my life.
Yeah, I like Lawrence Payne. He hired me 22 years ago, Gene, so I've got that Lawrence Payne connection as well. Hey, you went to Italy. You mentioned Argentina. I think you played in Israel for a while. So you're one of the few guys back at that time to go overseas. And, of course, Iceman was on with us. Matt Bonner was on with us. They've played overseas as well. What was that experience like, and how did it maybe change you, maybe mature you a little bit in terms of your global knowledge?
Well, it changed me a lot to the fact that, you know, I had ruptured my Achilles tendon when I was with the Bulls, and it was up in Philadelphia. And strangely enough, I never thought my career was over, but it was just something new for me to deal with. But I go, and Herb Rudor, who was my agent, an artist's agent, he put an artist and myself together to go play in Italy. We played in Bologna. It was that experience, it rained a lot. And I was just still coming back from my ruptured Achilles. And which was really interesting, I did try to get back into the league. I went with before the Charlotte Hornets was just Bill getting up. Mm-hmm. And the thing was that was one of the situations, then the Clippers as well. But being able to have that experience going overseas was amazing, to the fact that my baby girl, my oldest girl daughter, got a chance to start at school there. And then I played in Italy. Then I played in Paris, France for a year. And then I wound up playing in Israel for 4 years. And to be able to have that cultural expansion in my life, I got part of it coming to San Antonio, you know, with the Hispanic culture. But then I went there and I got the Italian culture. I went there, got the French culture. I went to Israel, got the Israeli and Palestinian culture. And then I went to Argentina and got, so it's the experience I've had. It's words cannot say of all the people would give their left arm to have the experience that I've had when it came to that.
Yeah, you've had an amazing life in basketball, Gene, not only as a player, but I remember interviewing you one time as you were an assistant coach with the Washington Wizards back around 2010, around there somewhere. But you've also been a scout. You're an assistant athletic director now, I believe. You're a special assistant to one of the presidents there at the college.
I've done a lot.
Something's
always happening with me, and I got to give God the praise, because, you know, I've had some great moments, but I've had some strategic tragedy situation. My wife passed away back in Isabel, who was there in San Antonio. She passed away, had a son pass away as well. A lot of people don't know about those stories because I kept them to myself because I had to deal with them. So we've had some trials and tribulations, and my mother-in-law just passed away last year, and she was the anchor to help me raise the girls. And we've had some highs and some lows, but you know, for some reason, you know, the girls kept me on the right path, doing the right things, not doing something stupid, you know, so because I had to do the right thing. And it was all about making sure that I did right by them and keep doing. And that was a great thing. And keep my faith. I mean, I haven't been strong in my faith, but I love God deeply because he's always been there for me. I'm just going to say that Jehovah God has been amazing where he's always been there to help me and been there to protect me and lift me up when things were, there were some rough moments that people never even know about, but my faith stayed strong. I didn't get angry. I didn't get bitter. I just had to move on because the girls, I had to do right because I'm a father and girls need their dads.
And now you're giving to others, Gene. And if you could give us a little background on the Gene Banks Foundation and the types of work that you're doing.
Well, the Gene Banks Foundation, and thanks for that, and I'm not saying that because he's here. Mike Harden has helped put that whole thing together. It's really just going out, helping things in the communities, and not just in one place in Greensboro, but Philadelphia. I did it in Canada. We were able to send like 20-something kids to Canada from the foundation, some scholarships. We help some kids, especially with in Philadelphia, they had some cerebral palsy situations. I'm revamping the foundation now because I did it really by myself a lot, but now I'm going to get a group behind it and make it really strong and bigger because we want to deal with some situations where there are a lot of kids that are homeless. The kids now are walling out and they need to be you got to keep them busy. That's the one thing. You got to keep them busy. And it's not just about sports. Sports is just a vehicle to keep them busy, but to try to get them to learn something about socialism and about their learning how to deal with their credit. There's a lot of stuff. And so the foundation reaches out. I mean, even when I was in San Antonio, I started the Gene Banks League down there. And on the east side, it brought Hispanics and African-Americans together. And Rick Lozano, remember Rick Lozano?
Sure, I remember Rick, yeah.
He and I are good friends. He was great in promoting it. And Henry Cisneros gave me a beautiful, beautiful proclamation. So the foundation is there for the needs of the young people, especially now. There's a lot of things that are going on. Kids are killing each other and so forth and so on. But and we got to get you got to get young Black kids to stop shooting other young Black kids. So there's a monument of things going forward that the foundation has been really good, but it's going to be bigger and stronger. And we're going to reach out to every area, not just Greensboro and Philadelphia.
Gene, we're looking forward to so much to you coming into the San Antonio area. You're hoping to maybe make a game this year. Is that right?
I've already talked to him. It's scheduled for February the 3rd. And hopefully that India will be, that's where she's born. That's the thing that we're going to try to do for her as a surprise.
Well, thank you so much for joining us, Gene Banks, episode 5, Sound of Spurs podcast, presented by Frost Bank. I followed you for a long, long time. I remember you when you were a 15-year-old kid at West Philly High, and here we are going full circle. But, Gene, thank you so much for your time. It's very important to have a guy like you on this podcast because this really brings back a lot of memories for a lot of Spurs fans through the years. And I know a lot of fans have very, very fond memories of seeing you wear number 20 for the Spurs.
Well, I just want to say that that was a part of my life that was so special. And they really engulfed the city and everybody there and it embraced me. And I still have a special place in my heart for San Antonio. I can't wait. I'm excited. I'm looking forward to it. People that I know, please. I want to see you when that happens. And I got goosebumps. I got goosebumps. Looking forward to it.
We look forward to seeing you, Gene. Thanks very much. That's Gene Banks, episode 5, Sound of Spurs podcast, presented by Frost Bank. I'm Bill Schoening. So long, everybody.